Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Curse of the Robo-Dragon, Space Wars, Book 1, written by Adam Blade and read by Theo Solomon. With special thanks to Conrad Mason. Avantia. Once upon a time, it was a lush, green planet with sparkling blue oceans. A haven for life in all its forms and a home to 8 billion people. A place of incredible technology and culture. Until the void. In Avantia City, it struck on a clear day at the height of summer. No one saw it coming. No one understood it. And no one was prepared. First, there was a roar, like distant thunder. Then a swirling vortex ripped apart the sky, streaked with vivid green and purple storms of electricity. It was vast, like the mouth of a monster. As earthquakes shook the ground, the citizens scrambled into any craft that could fly. They fled their homes, their very atmosphere, and from the darkness of space, they watched the void swallow their planet, leaving nothing behind. For most, it was the end. But for those lucky few, the survivors, it was only the beginning. Avantia 1, personnel. 1. Harry Hugo is a talented apprentice engineer and there's nothing he can't fix. 2. Ava Achebe is a cadet, training to be one of Avantia 1's elite space pilots. 3. Zoe Harkman, chief engineer, has taken care of Harry ever since his parents disappeared. 4. Marcus Knox, another cadet, thinks he's brave and daring. 5. Governor Knox is in charge of running Avantia 1 and protecting all the station's inhabitants. 6. Admiral Achebe is the commander of the space fleet and gives orders to the pilots. Chapter 1. Incoming. On the lowest deck of the Avantia 1 space station, among the crates of cargo, a small group of labourers had gathered to watch a slingshot contest. Harry Hugo loaded a blue energy ball into his sling's pouch and took aim. The target was 20 metres away, a circular piece of scrap metal from the engine of an old space wreck.
"Get a move on," said one of the other cargo workers, a wiry woman with her hair tied back in a bandana. "Our break will be over soon."
Harry drew the cord back, sighting along it. He was supposed to be running errands for his guardian and chief engineer of Avantia 1, Zoe Harkman, but when he'd seen the game in progress, he'd asked to join. Now, he was one more bullseye from winning a stack of credits, enough to upgrade the jets on his space stallion. He could feel several pairs of eyes on him, willing him to miss. For a moment, the only sound was the faint buzzing of the energy ball close to Harry's ear. He let fly. Whoosh! A streak of blue light tailed the ball like a comet as it shot straight and true. A chime rang out as it hit the target, shooting off sparks.
Yes!
Harry punched the air.
Youngster wins, muttered a huge, sweaty man with a scar running down vertically over one eye from forehead to cheek.
His name tag read, Jackson. He scooped up the credits in his tattooed arms and started towards Harry.
Whoa there!
The wiry woman stood between the two of them. She nodded at Harry's arm.
Anyone would win with tech like that.
Murmurs of agreement rose from the crowd. Harry felt his cheeks burning as he glanced down at his sling hand. He'd been born with one arm and used a state-of-the-art prosthesis he'd customized himself. The hand looked natural enough, with its super-smooth robotics and top-of-the-line synth skin coating. You could hardly hear the faint whine when he moved his fingers. But under the black sleeve of his cargo loader's overalls, the rest of his arm was a different story. Shiny rods of metal, blinking LEDs and interlocking cogs. Harry liked the robotics exposed. It made it easier to tinker, when he had the time. He would never cheat, though. He'd deactivated any tech that might help right before the competition. Harry switched the slingshot to his other hand. How about a redo? The woman's eyes narrowed suspiciously, but she nodded. Plucking a fresh energy ball, Harry loaded and took aim again. The silence of the cargo deck seemed even more intense this time, as though everyone was holding their breath at once. Harry realized that he was holding his too.
"Harry," said a tinny voice, "where are you?"
Harry groaned and lowered the sling. The voice was coming over his wrist communicator, and it belonged to Zoe Harkman.
Just got lost," he said into the device. "Well, you're wanted urgently on the flight deck," said Harkman. "Important job, apparently." "On my way," said Harry. He turned to the workers as he backed away. "Thanks for the game."
"What about your credits?" asked Jackson.
"I'll win them back another time."
He sprinted across the cargo hold, dodging a huge robotic lifter, then headed for the mole dock. Most people took the mole to get across the station. The network of transportation chutes carried pods between the different areas, a bit like an elevator, but traveling in every direction. An important job on the flight deck. Harry wondered what it could be. Perhaps he'd be working on a fighter jet's weaponry, or tinkering with a space cruiser engine, or even calibrating a navigation system. The mole pod was full, but he squeezed in. "Flight deck, please," he said, and the doors closed before the capsule sped off. The flight deck was many stories up. Harry looked at his reflection in the mirrored wall and saw he had a grease stain on his cheek. He wiped it with his sleeve, then smoothed down his mop of dark hair. With a bump, they came to a stop, one floor up, and the doors opened. Three officials in green uniforms were waiting. They looked at Harry, and one gestured for him to make way.
"Wait for the next one, kid."
He obeyed, stepping out. Instead of hanging about, he decided to find another route to his destination. Harry had lived on Vantia 1 for 8 of his 12 years, since the day the void swallowed his home planet, Avantia, and took his parents too. Their friend, Zoe Harkman, now chief engineer on Vantia 1, had adopted him, so Harry knew more than his fair share about how the station operated. That included all the shortcuts and back channels most inhabitants never used. He'd exited the mole pod on the farm deck, a series of giant interconnected tents where Vantia 1's food was grown. Harry hurried along one of the suspended walkways threaded between the multiple platforms, filled with greenery, fruits, grain and vegetables to feed the space station's thousands of residents. The air was warm and filled with moisture as he made his way past the hovering garden bots that constantly monitored the crops in the synthetic soil and sprayed them with water. The farm deck was hooked up to the same water system that fed the rest of the station, so Harry used a narrow service tunnel through the water treatment facility down to the leisure deck, where the 3D cinemas, sports facilities, and other recreational activities were based. People were milling about, with four sweaty tennis players leaving one of the zero-gravity courts. A group of kids were queuing to play a space simulator. Harry boarded another mole pod, along with several smartly dressed pilots. He was bouncing on his heels and rushed out in front of them when the doors opened on the flight deck, only to stop and suck in a deep breath. Ships of every size and description, from fighters to space yachts, transporters to landing craft, were dotted across the vast hangar. Some gleamed, as though freshly painted. Others were dented and rusty. It was an engineer's dream, and Harry's eyes drank it in. "Can I help you?" said a squat droid on caterpillar treads.
"Harry Hugo, reporting for duty," he said.
The droid beeped, then extended a spindly hand.
"You're wanted in the cadet section," it said.
Harry grinned and headed over.
The cadets were the trainee pilots who would one day make up the elite flying force of Vantia 1,
those entrusted with the most dangerous and sensitive missions. Only the very smartest and most able kids ever got in. Harry had wanted to sit the tests on his 12th birthday, but Harkman had refused, insisting he wasn't ready. "Anyway," he said, "what's wrong with being an apprentice engineer?"
"I want to explore," Harry had retorted.
"There's plenty still to explore in your textbooks," came the stern reply. Harry had argued, but his guardian's stubbornness was legendary. If Zoe Harkman said no, that was it. And besides, Harry knew the real reason for Harkman's refusal. He was scared. Scared he'd lose Harry too, the same way he'd lost Harry's parents on Avantia when the void overwhelmed the entire planet. As he approached the cadet section, he saw a boy not much older than himself, leaning against the side of the cadet carrier, the SS Nursifer. The boy was tall, with a sweep of blonde hair, and he wore the purple and gold uniform of the cadet force. Marcus Knox. Anyone on Vantia 1 knew his name, not just as the face of the cadet force, but as the son of the space station's governor. Marcus rolled his ice-blue eyes at the sight of Harry. "About time," he muttered.
"Sorry," said Harry. "I was down in cargo."
The boy's lips turned downwards, as if Harry had said he'd crawled out of a sewer.
"Well, you're here now. I need you to look at my seat."
"Your seat?"
"That's right. It's squeaking."
Harry could hardly believe what he was hearing.
"Squeaking? Is there an echo in here?" said Marcus. "Just sort it out."
Harry gritted his teeth. He knew the Nursifer's systems like the back of his hand. He'd spent hours.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.